Hello. Hello, pretty, pretty. You're very pretty, pretty, pretty. My name isn't pretty, pretty. It's Barbarella.
Incredible. What kind of girl are you? Have you no shame?
Barbarella psychedella. There's a kind of cockle shell about you.
Barbarella, Barbarella.
The beast has many weapons. This was one of them.
You have chosen a paltry kingdom on an insignificant planet.
And love.
Love is fleeting. Power is eternal.
Welcome to Journey Through Sci-Fi. With me, James.
And me, Matt. Every series on this podcast, we explore the world of science fiction cinema by taking a trip through a different subgenre of sci-fi.
This series, our journey is through the fantastical world of space opera.
Welcome back, listeners. Today on the podcast, we are talking about space fantasy. We are really delving into the world of the fantasy genre and where it crosses over with sci-fi via space opera. What a conflux that is.
Yeah, it gets very fantasy heavy in today's episode, doesn't it, Matt? There's lots of crazy beings floating around. There's angels. We've got crazy fantasy cyclopses. It's all just crazy fantasy this week.
Yeah, not the episode for the big fans of hard sci-fi. This is not hard sci-fi this week. I mean, this series on the show, it's not hard sci-fi, is it? But this episode, we're really straying away from sci-fi, right? Probably as far as we can get without becoming a fantasy film podcast.
Yeah, and we've often talked about our love of fantasy on the show. So I think this is the chance for us to properly embrace that as well, especially with the second film we're going to be looking at. But what films are we looking at today then, Matt?
So first up, we have got Barbarella from 1968, directed by Roger Vadim. And then after that, we're going to be talking about Krull from 1983, directed by Peter Yates.
Yes, lots of swords and swashbuckling and crazy fantasy escapades will ensue in today's episode. So much so that both me and Matt are dressed up in our fantasy attire right now. Matt's dressed up as a wizard, I am dressed up as a barbarian, and we are ready to get into this fantasy episode of the show.
I thought you were going to say, I'm dressed up like Barbarella. All right, well, with that mental image in mind, let's get started with Barbarella, James.
Meet the most beautiful creature of the future. Her name is Barbarella, and she makes science fiction something else. Jane Fonda is Barbarella. Barbarella is a five-star, double-rated astronavigatrix Earth girl whose specialty is...
love.
Shall I tell you what I would like?
I think I know.
Her top-secret mission is a real wing-dinger.
Yeah, sadly, I'm not dressed up as Barbarella, but I did think about it because it is a very iconic outfit that Jane Fonda is wearing in this film, isn't it, Matt?
Oh, it's more than one iconic outfit. She has about six costume changes.
It's a fashion fan's dream, this, especially given the year that it came out. So it came out in 1968, so it's full-on swinging 60s, and this film fully embraces that hedonistic lifestyle of the 60s. It's very free love. I mean, even in the very intro of the film, they're greeting is love, so it's going down that route, isn't it?
Yeah, it's the most 60s feeling sci-fi film I think I've ever seen. I mean, this came out in the same year as 2001 A Space Odyssey and Planet of the Apes, which is sort of baffling because this feels like the polar opposite of those kind of slow, cerebral, serious movies, and then your other option at the box office is to go to see Barbarella. I mean, to be honest, you're spoiled for choice. You need to be going to cinema three times at least, you know. I don't know if these would be out at exactly the same time, but yeah. God, what a time to be going to the cinema if you could watch all three of those films.
And what a year for science fiction as well, because yeah. You've got those two, absolute, the epitome of science fiction, 2001 and Planet of the Apes, films which come up again and again on the podcast because they are so good and they are two of my favourites. And then you've got this film, Barbarella, which definitely falls into our space opera category for this series because everything about it is space opera and it's camp and it's all the things which we said in our introductory episode that we remember about space opera. It's all of that kind of bright colours and fantasy stuff happening and it's very big and bold, isn't it? And it's a different kind of sci-fi to 2001 and Planet of the Apes. We talked about in one of the previous episodes about how Flash Gordon and Buck Rogers were attempts to get an adult audience watching sci-fi. This feels like they're getting a very teenage audience watching Barbarella at the same time. What do you think about that, Matt?
Do you reckon? Yeah, I don't know. I can see obviously why it would appeal to a teenage audience, especially a male. Yeah. But I don't know. I think it's more going for the kind of adults, hippie audience and trying to bring them into sci-fi. But trying to, you know, if you've got 2001 and Planet of the Apes, I don't think that's going to appeal to the kind of the hippie set as much. Or maybe it will because they're all on like acid, so they love 2001, getting their minds blown by that. But the more free love hippies of the 60s, I can't imagine being that attracted to Planet of the Apes and 2001. Whereas this is a kind of sci-fi that they might be sold on, they might be interested in.
Yeah, I can see that, and and like we said, it's the iconic costumes that are in this, and it feels very 60s. It reminded me of the sort of stylized bits that they've got in Austin Powers because it feels like that kind of parody sure. of it almost, yeah. doesn't it?
That's an interesting one, Austin Powers, because Austin Powers is so over the top parody of that time period. What it reminded me of was a kind of inverted James Bond. And obviously Austin Powers is a parody of Sean Connery, 60s James Bond. The way Barbarella kind of moves through the plot feels very much how James Bond would approach it, except she's got a completely different attitude to other people and particularly violence and stuff like that. Like, she has a completely different worldview to James Bond, but this does feel like a spy movie that she's on this mission, a sort of a secret mission sent by the President of Earth, and she has to go to this exotic location and meet all sorts of different people and romance with some of them in order to get her ultimate goal. That's a very James Bond plot line, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, and this person who she's after, Duran Duran, it has this weapon of mass destruction, just like any big James Bond villain. He's got this positronic ray. So yeah, I can completely see those comparisons. And that makes total sense for this time period as well, because you've got, like, James Bond is big.
Yeah, we're deep into the Sean Connery. I think Sean Connery was about to leave. Mm. So there would have been like four or five. I'm not up on my James Bond.
Apologies to our hardcore James Bond fan listeners.
Outside of the remit of this podcast. So.
Yeah, when we talk about Sean Connery, it's more Zardos level.
Zardos. Yeah, that's... Yeah, yeah.
Which, again, so,
apologies.
There's comparisons in this, though, because Zardos is like... It's like Sean Connery doing a Barbarella in his costume.
Yeah. Yes, it is, yeah. Which is, as we discussed, a truly traumatic visual image to remain in my mind.
Whereas this one, so it's really embracing Barbarella, Jane Fonda as this titular character. And she's the protagonist of the film. She's on this secret mission. And she's going to this weird planet to try and find Duran Duran. And there's lots of hijinks that ensue as a result of that. And it feels very episodic, doesn't it? Like we've seen with other space operas so far, and predominantly in the film serials, and even in Lost in Space. Lost in Space was episodes of TV. And I think there's something about that and space opera that is just so... it's just a part of the genre, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's inherent in space opera that the filmmakers want to showcase a lot of different places, sets, fantastical, impressive sets and locations, and move the character through those locations as quickly as possible in a film. In a serial, you do that by just featuring a new location in this episode of the serial. And likewise, in a comic book, Barbarella is based on a comic book called comic strip. Yep. One of those. Yeah. And in that, you just do that by this week's strip or this month's comic book. She's going to a new location. She's in the labyrinth this week or whatever. So when you're stitching that all together into a feature length movie, it does give it an episodic feeling. And I think that is kind of an inherent trait, which wasn't in that list of that kind of checklist that we talked about in the first episode. I don't think that was really covered, but I think it's actually quite important to the structure of a space opera film is to just rapidly move through lots of locations, and that leads to a very episodic feeling.
Yeah, and it really adds to that sense of adventure, doesn't it? And just on the topic of the comic strip that it was based on, so again, like we have a Flash Gordon and Buck Rogers, this again is becoming a trend in space operas that we're seeing, is a lot of them are based on comics. So we've got, with Barbarella, it was by Jean-Claude Forest, who created the character for French V magazine in 1962, and then it ran till 1964. And the book itself, the comic strips, they caused a bit of a scandal because it's an adult erotic comic book. And American audiences are seeing this and being like, what's going on here? And it's very highly sexualized, isn't it? It's got that feeling of the era of the 60s, and you're throwing a female protagonist in there, and you've got this female superhero who is often getting into adventures, and the adventures involve sex, just like James Bond, but it's Barbarella.
Yes. Yeah, so I can completely see why it would be a bit scandalous. And more than anything, I would imagine it's the on-screen nudity in the 60s that's more controversial than sex. Because, I'm not aware of controversy around James Bond having sex with a different lady in every movie he was in. But there wouldn't be any nudity, to my knowledge. Again, not a James Bond expert, but I feel like there's, you don't
get like Sean Connery's hairy chest and...
Exactly. Yeah. And a very firm kiss. Yeah. That kind of 60s kiss. What I was quite surprised by is that my memory of the film, I mean, I would have watched it when I was a teenager and just very much enjoyed like Jane Fonda in the film, sort of unashamedly. Yeah. But what I was quite surprised by rewatching it was that I thought it was like quite a wholesome nudity and treatment of sex on screen. Like Barbarella as a character, the performance of Jane Fonda, she's incredibly likable. She's so wide-eyed and innocent. And that's like the whole point of her character, because she exists in this futuristic post-violent universe, and post-sex even. They don't even have sex, so she's on her own sort of journey of sexual discovery. But it could be so much seedier, and I actually think that Jane Fonda's performance just holds the whole thing together with enough charm that it didn't feel nearly as seedy as I was expecting it to. I mean, what did you think about, you know, all of that stuff and how it was portrayed and how it comes off?
Yeah, it's a tricky one, isn't it? Because I kind of agree with you, but at the same time, this was the thing in the 60s of being this kind of sex kitten portrayal of women. And Jane Fonda was fully embracing that. She was that character. She'd gone from like, I think, more comedy roles to kind of creating this kind of sexual image around herself. She was a model. She did loads of like interesting stuff, Jane Fonda, as well.
She was very passionately opposed to the Vietnam War later on.
Yeah, she was an activist. And being an activist in the 60s, when we talked about Planet of the Apes, we were talking about all the activism that was happening around Vietnam at the time, and that film being a response to that. And Jane Fonda having all of that background as well, I think, brings something to her character. And I think she must have known what she was doing with this role. I mean, it's also worth bearing in mind that she was married to Roger Vadim at this point. So that would have had an impact on her taking the role. And like, there's loads of other crazy stuff that apparently may have happened during the filming. So have you heard about any of these rumors about the villa that they hired?
No, I don't know.
Well, you can guess what happened. It became like a big orgy villa, apparently. There's lots of rumors about this. And apparently they would invite people round and have drug-fueled orgies in between sort of the shoots and stuff. And it's all this kind of imagery of what the 60s was about. And yet, in this film, like you said, Barbarella is this character who's got a level of innocence about her. But at the same time, she embraces her femininity. She's all these characters are after her, basically. But she seems a bit, she doesn't really realize what's going on the whole time. So I think it's that kind of position I kind of wrestle with. Like, is that a good thing
that's
or is
interesting.
It bad?
Yeah, that's interesting that you say she doesn't know what's going on. That's quite a fine line, I would say, in the film as to whether she does know what's going on. She approaches the action with a sense of naivety, but I don't necessarily know if that means she doesn't know what's going on. It's more that she's unfazed by things. Or that's one reading of it. I don't know. Like, I don't know if it's definitive to say that Barbarella doesn't know what's going on just because she's never had physical sexual intercourse before at the start of the film. It's more that she's just coming at that situation from a position of, oh, right, okay, I've never done that. We do it differently on Earth, but I'll give it a go. That's her kind of attitude towards it. I think it's not quite right just to say she doesn't know what's going on. I think it's just that she's just very innocent and open as a character.
And I think that's why this film is quite a hard one to read, and one which critics didn't love it when it first came out. And since then it has become this cult film because of all of the stylization, iconography and everything that's going on with it. But there was one critic, Dave Kerr, who wrote, "The film is ugly on so many levels, from art direction to human values." And I think it's that human values aspect that you can get several different readings on in this film. It's all depending how you feel about Barbarella's character and how autonomous she is in her actions. I mean, she definitely becomes more and more autonomous as it goes on, because when she meets the character of Pygar, this angel, alien angel who we meet, she uses sex to almost manipulate him in a way, to get him to get his mojo back as in Austin Powers, and then be able to fly again. So she learns what people want in this world, which is sex.
Yeah, which is to have sex with them. Yeah. But again, I didn't see it as her manipulating the characters with sex. I feel like at the start of the film, she's never done it. She really, it clearly enjoys it with the catch man, or the
big,
slightly weird
the big
guy.
Hairy man in the ice.
Yeah, the child catcher.
Oh, God, that guy. And also just the children that they meet there, the crazy, creepy children.
The dolls. What did you think of the dolls? Because you don't like creepy
I was like, what the fuck is going on? Because it just escalates, doesn't it? First, you see these two little twin girls who are speaking in this alien language, which Barbarella can't understand. And then they're in this cave and there's
alien language. I think it's like German or French, isn't it? I think they're just speaking a European language, I think.
Oh, God.
I'm not sure.
No, because she says, is it French? Like, naturally, because also it's a French comic book. Nice little bit.
Oh, right. Okay.
And also Jane Fonda could speak fluent French. So she dubbed herself in the French version of the film.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah. Little fact for you there, Matt. But yeah, scary dolls, not a fan. They've got metal razor sharp teeth and they bite Barbarella to bits. It's not fun.
Listen, you children, this game is very amusing, but I think it's gone too far, huh? Come on, untie me or I'm going to call your parents. That's very sweet, but
Anyway, I was saying, I don't think she's being manipulative. I didn't find her manipulative with her interactions with Pygar. Again, I think I sort of saw it more as a sense of just going on this journey of self-exploration. She's just had sex for the first time and she's sort of somewhat psychologically unbaggaged about sex. Mm. So when she meets Pygar, they get along. It just seems natural to her to be like, well, you know, hey, thanks for saving me. Do you want to have sex?
Yeah. And it's the way that they, her culture on Earth view sex at this point. It's very similar to what we've seen in our dystopia series with stuff like A Brave New World and Sleeper, where sex is seen as this archaic thing that people used to do. And in this, it's also something that poor people do because they can't afford this special pill that they're talking about, and to able to do this weird touch your hands and your hair goes curly sex.
Yeah, which looks amazing, in fairness. Like when you do see that on screen, I kind of forgot that there's a scene where you do see sex or whatever you call it, partnering, whatever it would be called, the Earth version of that she finally does with Dildano. Very funny name, Dildano.
I mean, all the names in this are brilliant, aren't they?
Yeah. It's so camp.
It's very, very camp. And yeah, just still on the topic of Barbarella, I know that Jane Fonda put in her memoir that she saw it as it could have been a strong feminist move for her playing Barbarella, but she felt that it might have missed the mark slightly. Do you agree with that? Or do you think it could have been, she could have been stronger as a character and sort of like more feminist in her actions? Or
it could be a more feminist film for sure. I think there's like a spectrum of feminism to misogyny.
Mm.
And it's not on the like feminist end of that. But I personally don't think it's misogynistic, but there is obviously a very strong male gaze in the way that Jane Fonda is presented on screen from the very beginning. You know, it literally starts with a striptease, and that is very male gaze and not a particularly feminist way of opening a film about a female space superheroine character. So there is a way that it could have gone that would be much further down that side. Personally, because of Jane Fonda's performance and the way that she brings this charm and innocence to the character, makes that character for me not feel seedy and makes her quite a charming heroine that I quite like. So I don't think it's fully on the end of misogyny, I guess is what I'm saying. Mm. But for sure, you know, this could have been a stronger feminist movie. And I can understand why someone like Jane Fonda might look back on that a few years later and be like, oh, that's, you know, a bit disappointed with that, a bit annoyed that it kind of turned out that way.
Yeah, but they are all clearly having fun with making the film because it is so camp and ridiculous. And you've got this really eclectic group of characters. We talked about a few of them already. The catcher, basically a child catcher. Mm-hmm. Getting children from the forest with his hairy chest. You've got Pygar, this angel. You've got a character, the professor, who is a bit like a fawn, isn't he? He kept reminding me of Mr. Tumnus from Narnia for some reason.
Yes, he is a bit. Yeah.
All these characters that they meet in the labyrinth.
That's Marcel Marceau. I don't know if you know him. He's like the most famous mime artist of all time.
Is it?
Yeah. I think this is... I don't know how many speaking roles he had in his career, but I don't think very many. I think this was like very early for him doing speaking work. But you wouldn't tell. He doesn't really play it like a mime.
No, not at all. And then you've got the great tyrant, obviously, who is painted as the big villain of the film, but she doesn't become the big villain, does she? It's Duran Duran who overshadows her. But she's quite an interesting character as well because she just appears out of nowhere and she just calls Barbarella pretty. My pretty.
Yeah, she saves her as well. And it's strange, isn't it? Because has she got a name? She's referred to as the Great Tyrant a lot, but I'm sure she has a name, doesn't she? Maybe she's just called the Black Queen, the Great Tyrant. Maybe she doesn't have a name.
They refer to her by a lot of different names, don't they?
Yeah. She's presented as evil and we're told that she's evil and she has created this society or rules over this society that relishes evil, but she doesn't really do much evil acts on screen. She kidnaps Pygar.
Crucifies him.
But she's pretty chilled. Yeah, but she's pretty chilled out about just letting him down and letting him go. And she does toss him in the Mathmos lake.
I still think crucifying him's quite...
That's quite bad. Sorry. Yeah, that is... I don't want to undermine that. That's probably the worst thing she does. But in general, like the way she rules over society, she has this society that like is built on evil, a celebration of evil, a city that is entirely based on evil, Sogo. But that's just depicted as sort of decadence, I guess. I guess people are going around like trying to like kill each other. There's like dead bodies on the street, actually, isn't there?
Yeah. But because it is this fun film, you don't really notice bits like that sometimes. But there's also, aren't they smoking a man's essence or something in one of the bits? There's a bit which everybody talks about where there's a couple of people just using like what's it called? It's like a
this is after she escapes and but before she gets captured again by Durand. She just sort of tumbles into a room and someone basically offers her a joint.
Yeah.
And she's like, yeah, sure. What is it? And they say it's pure essence of man or something like that.
Yeah. Very strange.
Interesting. Interesting. What's most interesting is that the outer society where she learns about sex and falls in love with Pygar is also very decadent because, you know, everyone's just having sex, but I guess they're all like, they're kind of living in poverty, and it's kind of mostly a sex-based society in the city as well, but it's too far in the city. It turns evil in the city. It's all BDSM, but it's still all on a spectrum of sexuality, the levels of goodness and badness in the film. Because, like, Durand's the big villain, and he's got a positronic ray that's going to blast people into the fourth dimension, but he's also built a big... well, let's call a spade a spade. It's a big cum box.
I did not expect you to say that, but that's what it is. I was going to say it's a sex organ.
Yeah. Oh, that's a very witty way of putting it. Much more refined way of putting it than what I said.
Still, big cum box.
Yeah, it is an organ, isn't it?
Didn't they have a big cum box as well in High Life?
Yes,
yeah.
They did. And an even bigger, a cum
room.
Here
we go, sci-fi. It's always got space sci-fi. We're full of those cum boxes. Anyway.
I don't ever really edit this out.
I want to keep this in.
Thing, my dear. Sonata for executioner and various young women.
Oh, it's sort of nice, isn't it?
Yes, it is nice in the beginning.
But yeah, it's all about Barbarella's sexual awakening, the other side of the galaxy, away from the kind of peaceful but repressed sexuality of future Earth society. But then I guess like it goes too far sex wise and Durand Durand's created this weapon that he's trying to sex people to death with. But Barbarella's too sexy, I guess, and breaks it.
Yeah. That's, can't take it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the machine goes up in flames. And Barbarella's like, sorry, I'm very sorry that this happened. But yeah, Durand Durand has, it's almost, the way you talked about the societies, you talked about what Earth is like, and because sex is this thing where you have to take a pill and touch people's hands and your hair goes curly, in this world, it's kind of like he's gone off on the deep end, hasn't he? Because he's discovered all of this BDSM that's happening in the Citadel, and now he's fully embracing that, and he's like, okay, so evil is really, really good and really, really fun, and I'm going to conquer Earth because of it. And that becomes the galactic threat of the film, because we've talked about previously how in space operas there's always a big galactic empire, someone to overthrow. Blood must rain down the palace steps. There's got to be some big intergalactic threat that is there in the background, and Durand Durand becomes that threat in the film.
Yeah, he becomes the evil emperor. He usurps the evil emperor that we're introduced to, the Black Queen, or the Great Tyrant, becomes his own thing, which is more outwardly evil, because he's not just got his weird BDSM city to rule over. He wants to take over the galaxy, go back to Earth, and blast everyone into the fourth dimension.
And to combat that as well, they've got the rebels, haven't they? The rather rebellion that's going on. And this guy who's hidden underneath this bird cage. So there's a bird cage where Barbarella is put into, and she's attacked by all these birds, and then she slides down into the rebels' base, and the rebels just don't know what they're doing. They try and open a secret escape door, and then it doesn't work, so they just use the other door. The lights don't work.
Gets into real silliness. The guy playing Dildano is probably one of the funniest performances in the film. David Hemmings definitely gets, I would say, the most laughs. His general incompetence and the general incompetence of that rebellious faction, again, just kind of adds to the charm of the film, because they're supposed to be like the heroic faction who's going to, you know, overthrow this evil tyrant, but actually they're kind of a bit bumbling and a bit useless.
Yeah, even though he is a bit bumbling, they do manage to do it, don't they? And they get all of the people from the labyrinth. Just talking about the labyrinth quickly as well, we've talked about how it's episodic in its structure. You have got very clear settings for each part of the film, and very big set pieces. So you've got the ice bit at the start where you meet the catcher and the children. Then Barbarella goes into the earth, ends up in the labyrinth. And the labyrinth, it's such a fantasy scenario, isn't it? It's like the story of the Minotaur. It's all that kind of stuff comes with it, and all of those connotations. And then it goes into the city, and the evil city, just like in like a Wizard of Oz or something like that, where you've got the Wicked Witch. So it's got those fantasy elements in each of the set pieces, but they're still making it sci-fi by having it be set on this weird planet, and you've got this futuristic technology. So it's kind of mixing both worlds, isn't it?
Yeah, more so than the film we'll be talking about later. This, it feels like it's always anchored in science fiction, but a very, the science fiction of a comic book artist in the 1960s who is more interested in impressive visuals than science in storytelling. It's not about that. It feels that way from the very beginning, not just the fact that it starts with the striptease, but the striptease takes place in Barbarella's spaceship, which is a good introduction to the type of sci-fi that we're dealing with, because that spaceship doesn't look like any other spaceship in fiction. It's got like a shag rug that is on the floor, walls and ceiling, completely, you know, encasing the entire space. And there's a statue, there's a what looks like a piece of artwork, but it might be one of those folding screen doors that you can have to change behind, I think, with an artistic print on it. But whatever, there's art around it. It's not normal really to have this lavishly decorated artistic spaceship on film. It stands in immediate contrast to what you might expect a sci-fi opening to be like.
And it feels very rooted in the 60s, doesn't it? Often we talk about how sometimes the settings in sci-fi films from earlier periods might date. This is very dated in the 60s, but it still works, doesn't it? Because it just feels like the world of the film, and the world of the film is this kind of 60s mentality.
Yeah, it's so dated, it goes full circle and it becomes timeless. Like, it's one of those films, it's such a, it is a pure artifact of the late 60s, and that will never look dated, because it feels, to someone born like 20 years later, like who has no experience of the 60s, it feels like this depiction of the 60s that has sort of settled into the cultural understanding of what the 1960s looked like for those of us that weren't there. It's like this, and, you know, newsreel footage of Woodstock, you know, that kind of imagery that sums up the decade. This feels like part of that visual framework.
Yeah, and it's that psychedelic nature of the 60s as well, which feeds into this fantasy that is happening on screen, because you've got all of these crazy characters, but it just seems, well, it could be like a massive trip that you're going on during this film, and you're meeting all these characters. They're all having sex. It's all free love. And it just all feeds into what an audience might expect from this kind of film at the time. And also because the original comic book is French. Do you get like a feeling of Frenchness from the film at all?
Yeah, sure. But, well, I think it feels very European.
Yeah, European more than just French, of course.
Yeah, but I don't know to what extent that's the Jean-Claude Forest French writer influence from the comics, so I've never read the comics, or how much it's Dino De Laurentiis' Italian influence. A lot of De Laurentiis' films feel quite European. Flash Gordon feels very European. He casts a lot of European actors in it. Marcel Marceau is a French guy, for example. So there's that as well. There's the production of the film. And also there's going to be some influence there. I just think, like, you know, European attitudes towards sex are different to American attitudes towards sex. Whereas, you know, or even American and British as well, you know, British films like the James Bond films at the time, the purely kind of male focused attitude towards sex, this male conqueror that of James Bond just going around like shagging all the women as he's on his mission. That's why it feels perhaps unusual and counterculture to focus that on a woman instead in Barbarella.
Yeah, you can see that with this as well. And I think there's also something just to be said about French science fiction in itself, because there's another film which we're going to be looking at later in the series called Valerian. And Valerian was based on a French science fiction comic. Also, if you think about Planet of the Apes, Planet of the Apes was written by Pierre Boulle, and that's a French novel as well. So I think having this European voice in science fiction is something that's there in the background, but we're not fully seeing until sort of around this period, where the film world has blown up a bit. You're getting more influences from European cinema, and all of this is adding in to this kind of film, where you've got a very European aesthetic to everything, as well as it just being very 60s.
I wonder if, do you know Mobius, the comic book artist, Jean Giraud? I wonder if he was working around this period as well. He's French, and he does beautiful, very space opery, fantastical science fiction worlds. That's kind of his thing. You should look up some of his art if you've not seen it. I'm sure you'd recognize it, because he kind of gets into everything. I think he might have done some work on films like The Fifth Element later in his career, but I think he was active in the 60s, I think, or maybe he kind of got big later, but primarily working in comic books. I know Jodorowsky had him working on Dune when he was attempting to make that. So the kind of style of that was heavily influenced by Mobius's work as well.
I think that must help with exotic alien character design and set building and all of that, because you're coming from a different angle rather than just like an American viewpoint or a British viewpoint. You're seeing all of these worlds that you're creating in a slightly different light, so you can create them in a different way. And I think that's where you get some really fun science fiction, when you're embracing these other cultures from around the world, as well as just these fantasy cultures which you're creating and putting on screen.
And it has created, I think it's an enduring iconic film. And it's interesting to talk about how it's aged or how it's dated and how appropriate some of the themes of it are. I think it's very interesting that this is a film that there's always been interest in remaking, but that's never come to fruition. And I think that there's something in that. Why hasn't anyone been able to do that? It can't be that hard, you know. If someone was that interested in it in Hollywood, it would just get made in the 50 however many years it's been.
Well, initially they were going to do a sequel at one point called Barbarella Goes Down. Yeah. And it was going to be about her going on an underwater adventure, something like that.
Oh, brilliant. Oh, that would have been so good. Yeah, that sounds great.
That was the initial plan. And they had, like, there were rumours about Jane Fonda's daughter potentially playing the role of Barbarella. So that was one thing that never quite came to fruition. Then Robert Rodriguez, after he'd made Sin City, proposed a remake of Barbarella. But the price tag for this remake that he would have done would have been $80 million. So Universal were like, no, I think we're gonna back down from this one. So that never came to be. But they've also tried doing a TV series, which didn't come about. But recently, as in last year, 2022, Sydney Sweeney, who is one of the stars of Euphoria, she's set to produce and star in a new version of Barbarella, which could be interesting, just seeing what these kind of themes in Barbarella and the 60s mentality, how it would transfer to a remake now, and how you could twist that story into something, I don't know, something different, something interesting. Because what do you feel like is the real message of this film? Is there one?
Yeah, the kind of love trumps all kind of thing it comes up time and time again in various forms. Like you said, the greeting between the president and Barbarella is just love. And there's kind of a muddled sense of meaning around an angel does not make love, an angel is love, because that gets repeated. And then Pygar like saves everyone and says he has no memory. Kind of hard to pick apart what they're trying to say in that. It feels like that's they're trying to communicate the overall message in that moment with Pygar choosing to save them because he has no memory of the tyrant's evil deeds. Basically just hippie free love, forgive and forget, turn the other cheek stuff, right?
Yeah, I think that's kind of what it's going for with this. And also it's a fun romp. It's a fun camp romp.
Yeah.
That's what it is at the end of the day. It's got all of these crazy sets and costumes, which are iconic now. There are so many people which have like reinvented these costumes, used them in other sort of sets and things like that. You think of even people like Alice Cooper have quoted Barbarella as being an inspiration for the way that he dresses, which is mad.
Okay.
So right. Barbarella, the great tyrant in the film, apparently Alice Cooper has cited her.
Oh right, yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah,
the
yeah.
The switchblade hands, the gloves that she's got in one of the yeah. scenes, he's like, well, that's directly from this. But then at the same time, he's also said like Sweet Baby Jane, and there's a few other sort of film references that he's made about what gave him his iconic look. But it's interesting that Barbarella was one of the things that contributed to that.
Yeah, it has that lasting legacy. I think it is it's genuinely iconic for the reasons we were talking about the fact that it's so dated but not dated, that it's going to last forever, I think, the imagery of this film, which is a good thing. Like, and you know, that makes it a good film, you know, in that respect. It's a cultural icon. Put it in the Library of Congress or whatever it was.
Yeah, put it in the vault. It's fit on plot, but it's big on style. Fit on plot, big on style. I think that's going to be a recurring thing that we say throughout the series looking at space opera. But this is definitely an
perfect
example.
Space opera in that sense, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly. Yeah. Well, shall we start talking about another film, which may or may not be style over substance again, Krull from 1983. Hi listeners, if you're enjoying the show and want to support what we do, you can sign up to our Patreon by going to patreon.com/journeythroughscifi.
And if you subscribe at the warp speed level, you'll get access to our regular bonus episodes as well as the whole back catalogue.
We've got a host of mini-series like deep dives into the Terminator and Planet of the Apes franchises, as well as the Bad Movie Bunker and reviews of the latest sci-fi films.
Plus, you'll get a say in the kind of content we make for our patrons.
We hope to see you there.
On a distant planet, a great kingdom was ravaged by beings who came from the future to conquer the universe.
Bowen!
Now, the only survivors follow a doubtful seer and a throneless king.
They will hold her in the Black Fortress. You must have help.
At the end of an impossible journey, they must fight an invincible enemy.
is the knowledge you seek?
I shall be your king.
In the fortress, you will face more than the slayers.
What is about to happen to them could never have happened on Earth.
So, James, I'm completely new to Krull. This was the first time I'd seen it. What about you?
Same here. It feels like it's a gap in my knowledge because
yeah.
It's such a cult film. I mean, Barbarella was a cult film as well, but for sci-fi fantasy nerds like ourselves, I feel like Krull is a big one that a lot of people saw when they were younger and grew up with.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised you haven't seen it. I'm kind of surprised I haven't seen it. This feels like the kind of film we both would have watched when we were kids, and I wonder why it didn't sort of land on our radar in the same way that, yeah, Flash Gordon's and similar 80s films did become quite big in our consciousness.
Yeah, it's interesting that, isn't it? And I mean, this film came out post-Star Wars, so it's yet another of the many, many post-Star Wars films which we'll be discussing this series. And its origins are quite interesting as well. So Frank Price, who was in charge of Columbia Pictures, wanted to do a swashbuckling adventure fantasy story and then ended up in space, because I think, again, this must have been a influence of Star Wars. So in the same vein as what we saw in The Black Hole, where that was a disaster film in space, which ended up becoming more of a space opera post-Star Wars, I feel like maybe this had some of those elements going on as well, because it feels like it should have just been a fantasy film, but it's got these added elements that make it space fantasy.
Yeah, well, something I quite like about it is that slightly awkward mashup that they do to make it a sci-fi film, because it essentially becomes a fantasy movie in the vein of Legend or something like that. You know, it becomes a total fantasy movie, but I quite like the way the villains are always just kind of showing up and like blasting them with laser rifles, and they feel kind of like stormtroopers. I'd quite like to see something like this done, but leaning more into the sci-fi, but still having the contrast of, you know, a sci-fi alien emperor invading a traditional fantasy setting planet, having these sci-fi characters facing off with fantasy characters. That's a really fun concept that this film just hints at, because the producers wanted to wedge more Star Wars into it. I think you could go a lot further with that and make something really, really quite silly but fun.
Yeah, I think it's the idea of that clash of cultures, isn't it? The medieval fantasy aesthetics you usually get in those kind of films versus lasers and guns and spaceships. So someone flying on a dragon fighting a spaceship is kind of what I want to see, which you kind of get in Avatar in a way. You get that kind of almost flying on dragons, but not in the same way.
No, I want that medieval fantasy, the knights in armor and wizards and stuff fighting stormtroopers, basically. I just wanted more of that. I thought it was a great visual.
I was thinking of a film which is from my youth, Masters of the Universe, and that's got that cross, hasn't it?
Yeah, that's a similar sort of thing on the space fantasy side, isn't it?
Yeah.
And space fantasy and, what's the other way of referring to this? Science fantasy. It feels like that term is perfectly made up for a film like this. It's fantasy set in space. That is what it is. Science fantasy I don't particularly like as much as a term, because it sounds like you've taken the phrase science fiction and replaced fiction with fantasy. And of course, it's not the fiction side that's being replaced. It's the science side that's being replaced by fantasy.
Be honest, so it's not.
Science fantasy does not feel like the right term for a film like this.
Exactly. But it is still very much on the cusp of sci-fi, isn't it? It's got those sci-fi bits. It's an alien taking over a planet. And then also there's stuff about the king and queen's son who's going to be the ruler of the galaxy. It's a galactic story, but in a very localized setting of this planet of Krull.
Yeah, yeah. That's why I just wanted a little bit more. I just want a little bit more sense of that galaxy. Because it starts out, oh man, the opening shot with the Black Fortress flying through space. It looks amazing. It's a stunning model. It looks like a Star Destroyer, but made of rock. It's a very cool design. So that's very exciting. But then it lands and it just turns into a rocky fortress. So we don't get enough of that galactic sense of space, apart from being told that their child's going to rule the galaxy and seeing a little bit of a spaceship at the start.
The way that we've got the characters being introduced in as well kind of tries to tell you that it's in this far off planet, a galaxy far, far away, if you will. You've got characters like the Cyclops, who is a character that is said to have been from another planet who ended up on Krull. And then he's got an interesting backstory about how his people used to have two eyes, and then they got one of the eyes taken away by the Beast, and then they had gained this power to see their own deaths. So they've got that sense of the other planets and the other worlds. And then also in the way that the palace guards are as well, they're kind of like, they look more alien in nature when you get past their armor, their leather armor.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. When they crack them
open.
I
feel like that wasn't, I was waiting for more of an explanation of that, because sometimes when they get killed, a little slithery, bloody slug disappears into the earth below them. And I was kind of waiting for more of an explanation of what they were, but that's just what they are. They're just little slugs in suits of armor, I guess.
It doesn't come, that explanation, though, does it? And there's a lot of bits like that don't come in the film, because it's a 2-hour film, but it moves at quite a pace. There's lots going on all the time.
Yeah, well, again, it's that episodic structure, more from a fantasy background. But again, it's where fantasy and space opera cross over, because they both have this, both of those genres have this impetus to move us through different locations and show us different places, different fantastical locations. We've got to see the swamp, the cliffs, the ravine where he meets the bandits and recruits them, and ultimately get to the Black Fortress at the end for the big assault on the fortress. That feels very episodic in a very similar way to Barbarella, and as we were saying, like Flash and Buck Rogers as well.
Yeah, but I think the thing that separates it from a lot of sci-fi maybe is there's like a slight lack of exposition as to what's going on. Like there's yeah. There's lots of stuff that's happening and they just sort of say, oh, it's because of this really quickly. And then you don't actually understand why, what they're doing. Like even when our main character finds the glaive, the iconic glaive from the film, this weapon which will help him defeat the Beast, which is basically like a shuriken, crazy shuriken, which looks very dangerous to use. I mean, fucking hell, I would not want to fling that about. Fuck me.
Yeah. You have to hold it by the blade.
Yeah. And then if you're catching it when it comes back, I mean, I know he can use his mind to control it.
Yeah,
but
it's magic.
But fucking hell, scared the crap out of me. I wouldn't even want to handle that.
I know.
Just full of razor blades. But yeah, they don't explain that they say, oh, you've got to go up there and get the glaive. What the fuck's the glaive? What's going on? Who are you, old man? Where have you come from? It's all just such a pace.
Yeah, it's all an original story, isn't it? It's not based on a novel or anything like that, to my knowledge.
No, but there were rumours that initially it was going to be a Dungeons & Dragons film.
It certainly borrowed from Dungeons & Dragons, if not officially taken anything. But it almost feels like it's supposed to be based on something, because all of that stuff is so so poorly explained, to be fair. Who is the old man? Why does he need to go and get the glaive? What is the glaive? It sort of feels like you're supposed to know already, because it's based on like 10 books and the glaive is explained in extreme detail in the books. And it feels like we're just kind of dropping in to a more well-established fantasy world, but we're not. And they're actually just doing quite a poor job of of introducing us to this fantasy world, even if it maybe exists quite thoroughly in the director and the screenwriter's heads. That's not well communicated, and it feels like a lot of random fantasy elements have just been thrown on screen.
Yeah, it's just that it kind of lacks that texture that you kind of want, that kind of mythology aspect. You want to know a little bit more about what's actually going on. But to be fair, you understand the basic plot from the start. The prince has to go and save his bride from this evil alien that's invaded his home planet, and then he gets a fellowship of companions and they are going to go and save the day. That's all you need to know, and they're going to go on lots of adventures in order to get to the Dark Fortress, which keeps moving. I mean, that's so fucking annoying. If you're trying to track down this palace that's going to move every day, just anywhere, that was just like, oh, I was annoyed for them more than anything about that.
Yeah, because the driving force that's sending them through all these fun scenes in different locations is to find the Black Fortress. But before finding the Black Fortress, they have to find a way to find the Black Fortress. So that takes them to the Emerald Seer, but the Emerald Seer can't do it. So the Emerald Seer takes them to the Emerald Temple and then dies. And then the old man has another way, which involves climbing through a big spider's web, and that's going to help them see
his old missus.
They're just, there's lots of, it's very MacGuffin-y, isn't it? Just lots of different ways to get them to different places.
But that's exactly what Flash Gordon was, wasn't it? When we looked at the film serials, yeah. It's just another adventure for this week.
Yeah, and I don't mind it. You know, it's not necessarily a criticism to say that. I think that is inherent to the genre. It's all about showing us, it's all about just getting us to different episodic scenes where there's going to be a fun new monster or quicksand or something like that. Excitement, danger, peril, all of those things. And when you accept that and you start watching space opera films as we are, you can have quite a lot of fun with that if you're not too worried about the MacGuffins and all of that.
And it feels like, do you remember those old games you used to play on really old school computers? I can't remember the names of them.
Like text-based adventure
games.
Zork. There's one just called Adventure, I think.
Will you go into the Dark Forest? There's a key. Yeah. Will you pick up the key? Again, Dungeons and Dragons. It's that kind of idea. And that's where fantasy is at its strongest, where you've got these adventures that are happening. So you've got really big set pieces that can add to that sense of spectacle that's happening on screen. And some of the best moments in this are the silly places they go. I mean, you talked about when they went to go and see the massive spider woman, which is just Lord of the Rings, but they've got that moment. And again, I say it's just Lord of the Rings. It's become like an iconic fantasy staple now. There's a spider lady or something like that. So there's that bit. They go to a swamp. There's always a swamp. Every single fantasy film I can think of has like a dark swamp that they have to cross and quicksand.
Well, it's a very never-ending story moment in the swamp, isn't it? Except it's much more sad when the horse dies than when the man dies in Krull.
But that goes back to ancient fairy tales as well, and the idea of the forest being this dark, mysterious place. So if you go into the forest, something's going to happen. You're going to learn something by the end of the story. That's where all the creatures live. Whereas in space opera, you're going out into space and that becomes the forest. So it's in fantasy, it's more about the natural world that you're going into. Whereas the only difference with space opera, it's a natural world found on a different planet, which makes it more exotic. So it's following the same sort of trends, isn't it?
It is, but that's where it stops feeling like sci-fi for me, because it doesn't have the visual language of sci-fi. It has the visual language of fantasy, which is the natural world, like you said. It just doesn't look like an alien world. It looks like medieval Earth.
Yeah, it looks like Britain, doesn't it? And especially given the predominantly British cast.
It looks like Britain. It looks like British woods, or some scenes look very American as well. Yeah. Like the cave where he gets the glaive looked like, I don't know, Arizona or something. It looked like something out of a Western movie.
And that kind of roots it in that firm reality of a world, and going back to the sort of the medieval aspects of it, because medieval is a timeless kind of staple of fantasy. Having you don't need to advance your technology because you've got magic this kind of crosses those borders because there is magic in this world, but there's also laser guns and aliens coming down. But then you never quite know if the beast's power is sort of sci-fi alien in nature, maybe, like, I don't know, like telekinesis or something, or if it's magical in nature. So this could have been a way they could have done it. They could have lent more into that. So the beast is all about the sci-fi special powers, and then the other world, the magic world, has to combat that.
Yeah.
But you don't have to. That's me going off on one.
This isn't the kind of film that's going to
do that.
It's not going to give you any of that, like, detailed explanation of what's going on, I guess. It's much like Barbarella, though. It's just, what did you say? It's a strong light on plot, strong on visuals. Like, that's what we've got again. And it really is. Like, it's not important, really. And you do get that sense that the sci-fi elements have just been kind of thrown in the mix at a fairly late stage of pre-production because they don't gel. But that clashiness of those elements, like I said, is something that I found quite fun and I would have liked to see more of. But because they haven't been inserted to create a sense of fun, they've been inserted to cash in on Star Wars and sci-fi.
Yeah, the elements which struck me as well were, like, when they're fighting the guards, there's just like flashes of red lightning, isn't there, or blue lightning, and then they've got the occasionally you see someone with a gun, but a lot of the time you don't really know where these lightning bolts are coming from.
Yeah.
But I mean, again, it's fun, it's silly.
Yeah, it's magic.
It's magic. It's all magic. And any good, what's the quote? Any good science is indistinguishable from magic. And in this case,
sufficiently advanced science. Yes. Yeah, it's indistinguishable from magic.
But in this case, all just magic and fantasy, which is...
It's actually just magic.
Yeah. But the comparisons between sci-fi, space operas and fantasy films continue in the way you've got this fellowship of companions, because it feels... The more we're going along this series, you need to have a strong group of characters like banding together in order to take on this adventure. And that feels like a very fantasy element, doesn't it? How did you feel about that in this film?
Yeah, it's the fellowship, isn't it? That he's forming a fellowship, which is most iconically... I mean, fantasy doesn't have like the copyright on the concept of a fellowship. It's just that it always happens in fantasy, and it's been made incredibly famous by Lord of the Rings primarily, but also, you know, basically every other fantasy that followed in the steps of Lord of the Rings. But yeah, you get that sense. We're seeing that sense. I think felt it most strongly in Flash Gordon, in the Flash serials, where he goes around over a few episodes and just makes friends, and he forms his merry band of warriors that are going to help him overthrow Ming. And that's exactly what Colwyn does in Krull, but he's doing it proactively. He needs a gang because he's this exiled, usurped prince turned king who needs to basically reestablish his kingdom. So he needs his merry band of warriors to be that guy, basically.
Literally all of his subjects have been killed. All of his army has been killed in one foul swoop as well. So he's got no other option but to get this band of convicts and crappy magicians together.
Because the tone of this film stays fairly light all the way through, you don't ever really feel the weight of his entire kingdom being massacred on the day of his wedding. You know, that doesn't... The weight of that and the meaning of that doesn't really resonate particularly. It's just he goes straight on his adventure. And
he does look very sad when it first happens, though, and he screams. Just sure. A really quick scream. I probably laughed at that moment because it just looked... It just felt so bad.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, that's... I guess that's what it feels like when a film of this tone tries to deal with that and get that out of the way, I guess, get that narrative weight out of the way so that they don't really have to deal with it for the rest of the film.
Yeah, they can carry on with all the fun stuff. And there is a whole lot of fun happening in this film. As much as I've talked about the different elements which may not quite work, it's fun, isn't it? You've got these
absolutely, yeah.
Yes. Out of the characters, then, who were your favourites?
I liked the... Oh, I can't remember his name now. I feel really bad. But the one who was like a useless wizard and he could only turn himself into an animal, like seemingly by accident, turns himself into like a goose and a dog. And he finally like nails it at the end. He turns himself into a tiger and he actually... Ergo the Magnificent.
For that rudeness, lout, I think I'll turn you into a bat. Might teach you some manners to hang upside down for an hour or two.
The hill people lack the power to do harm.
We shall see about that, old man. We'll see about that. Now, that's a recipe for hot fudge sauce. Oh, well, it'll have to be a goose. Fat and ugly.
Very fat, very ugly.
Yes, Ergo, who's played by David Battley, who is also one of the teachers in Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Is he?
Yeah. He's got such an iconic-looking face as well. Yeah. I felt like I recognised him as soon as I saw him, but I couldn't think of why.
I thought he was Eric Idle, to be honest.
Yeah, there's that as well. He looks a bit like Eric Idle. When he first drops down, his voice sounds just like Eric Idle.
Yes, he's like doing an Eric Idle impression, kind of.
Yeah, he was great. And then they've got the Cyclops, who I really enjoyed.
I like the Cyclops. He's a great character. The self-sacrifice and the sense of doom, knowing his own death. I really did like that.
The fact that he waits behind and then goes, I'll catch up with you guys later, because he knows he's gonna die.
Well, I assumed he was going to die with the horses somehow.
So
and that's
did
why
I.
He said he'd wait behind.
And then he's like, nah, fuck it. I'm going to go and join the rest of them and then die in a spectacular fashion. But it's not exactly a spectacular fashion. It's built up so much that he can see his own death. So you're going to see it at some point.
Yeah.
And then when it does happen, he just gets crushed in a door, not even a door, between two... like a cave,
two bits
of wall. He gets crushed and then that's the end of him. And then they just go, right, we've got to carry on because there's lots of shit to do in this palace.
I have to say, I really like Colwyn as well. I think he's a really good hero for this type of film.
Yeah.
He's like Flash Gordon. He's like Buster Crabbe. Like he's just sort of a swashbuckling, likable young hero. He really reminded me, and the whole film really reminded me of the Princess Bride, and he reminded me of Westley from that. Unfortunately, that was a bit of an unfair comparison because the Princess Bride is a movie that I absolutely love, and this feels like the Princess Bride taking itself too seriously. It's got all the fun and adventure and fantasy of the Princess Bride, and it looks the part, but it's not really got much of a sense of humor. And obviously the Princess Bride really goes into that and it becomes a sort of metatextual comedy. I'm not saying that Krull should go all that way, but it's just because it feels so similar and so close to the Princess Bride, but just kind of po-faced and serious. That's an unfavorable comparison, but it's still enjoyable and it's got a lot of the fun of the Princess Bride.
Yeah. And it's almost like it's one of the first, well, I don't know if it's one of the first, I don't know enough about the history of fantasy films, but it feels like it's the precursor to a big influx of fantasy films that are going to happen throughout the 80s. Like Labyrinth comes out, Princess Bride comes out. I'm thinking of Willow. I'm thinking of Legend later on. It feels like there's stronger fantasy films to come, but this is the like one of the first big attempts at doing a big on-screen fantasy film. Again, I don't know that for definite, but it just feels like that.
I think you're right. I think the sort of timeline of influence of Dungeons and Dragons becoming incredibly popular prior to this, and also throughout the 80s, the sort of influence of that, and there's all that satanic panic around Dungeons and Dragons, but it became incredibly popular, so it starts to influence film and TV. And fantasy becomes a stronger genre in those times. And it's funny that they're trying to wedge in the late 70s sci-fi influence into this film, but this fantasy wave is going to take off after this. And I don't know, sci-fi maybe gets usurped a little bit in the 80s by fantasy.
Yeah, and just going back to the cast as well, there are some other familiar faces in this. Of course, we've got Liam Neeson, who makes a little appearance. And when I was watching this film, I sent you a picture of Liam Neeson in this and someone else who you didn't recognise.
I've never felt so old. I do know who that person is. I just don't know what he looks like.
So I sent a comparison photo between Liam Neeson's character Keegan in this and Post Malone, popular singer/rapper from the new generation.
You made me feel so old, bro. I know who Post Malone is vaguely, but I didn't know he looked like that.
No, it's just because the specific picture I sent was Post Malone rocking exactly the same hairstyle Liam Neeson in this film. So I found that just hilarious when I was watching it. Just Liam Neeson starting that fashion trend early.
And we got Robbie Coltrane as well, who I thought was barely recognisable as Robbie Coltrane. He's doing an English accent, for starters.
He's dubbed.
Oh, is he? It's not even his voice.
He's dubbed, apparently. Okay. Yeah, which is
fair enough.
And no wonder he's not recognisable.
Oh, bless him.
Yeah, he's dubbed by Michael Elphick.
Oh, that's insane, though. It's medieval fantasy.
Yeah.
You can have a mixture of British accents. That's what medieval fantasy is all about. I mean, Liam Neeson's got his natural accent. He hasn't been dubbed.
Yeah, but you know, Princess Liss has been dubbed as well.
Yeah, she sounds insane.
Yeah.
She's very clearly dubbed. She does not, that voice is not coming out of that woman.
She's like a 19-year-old actress or something, and then the voice is from a 35-year-old woman from America called Lindsay Cruz, who...
Why?
Yeah, much more mature sounding voice. And that's why they wanted her to be the voice of the princess.
Well, why not cast a more mature woman?
Yeah.
If you want a more mature voice. So weird.
It's mad. But hey, that's what happened in the film. But yeah, Robbie Coltrane, great to see him. Got Mark Fowler from EastEnders, Todd Carty. Did you recognise him?
No.
No, not at all. No. Any of our non-British listeners would just be like, what are you talking about? There's a very famous TV actor called Todd Carty. I say very famous. Matt did not know who he was, but he's like, he's a young guy who later goes on to be in EastEnders and The Bill and stuff like that. And I enjoyed his appearance in this as well. And even just the Cyclops, apparently, Bernard Breslau, he is from the Carry On films.
Is he?
Yeah. So again, and Torquil, Alan Armstrong, who we see time and time again in lots of films, very famous actor. It's got a very British cast, which I didn't quite expect from this.
Yeah, it's a big British cast. I did look up Ken Marshall, who plays Colwyn, and it seems like he never really did anything again after this.
He hit his peak.
He was a bad guy in a few episodes of Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
Ah.
Like, he was a recurring... I'm pretty sure he's a bad guy. He's like a... He's a Starfleet officer who goes rogue or something like that, I think. He's very good in that, to be fair, but I don't really think he's done much else after Krull.
Mm. Someone who has done quite a lot since Krull is the guy who made the music, James Horner.
Oh my God, the music is so good. The music is one of the things that really brings the whole film together, doesn't it?
In that intro sequence when it just came in, I was like, I'm in a space opera right now. This is what it means to be in this kind of epic film.
Yeah. James Horner really just firing on all cylinders, score wise. This would be around the time... What year is this? This is 83. So I'm trying to remember, because he did an amazing score for Star Trek 2.
Yep.
Which would have been roughly the same time, I think. So he's not at the peak of his skills, because he's going to go on to do all the work with James Cameron.
Yeah.
And that's been great as well,
because he does Braveheart, Apollo 13, Titanic. He worked on My Heart Will Go On with Celine Dion.
He wrote My Heart Will Go On, and he wrote ICU for Avatar as well, which basically sounds like the same song as...
So, I mean, this guy, and he's doing Krull at this point, and it's just because the music feels so big in this film.
Yeah, it brings authenticity to the film, doesn't it? A fantasy requires a fantastical soundtrack. You need to feel a sense of fantasy in the music, and without that, you're going to lose your audience. So James Horner he's putting a shift in for Krull, for sure.
Yeah, and even the film's like it really works on that spectacle. They had 23 sound stages they used at Pinewood Studios. They've put a lot of money into it. They spent 30 million on this film, which is a lot for that time period as well. So they've really gone all out with that to try and make it this big fantasy epic.
And it is a big fantasy epic, but it was a big flop, wasn't
it? Yeah.
I don't think it even made that money back.
No.
Which I mean, I don't know why, but it may account for why you and I were not aware of it when we were kids, because clearly it wasn't a success and it's taken a long time maybe to become a bit of a cult film.
Yeah, well, it got 16 million apparently in the box office. So it's not recouped at all, but in its defense, it was going up against Superman, Jaws, two James Bond films. So that may have had something to do with it.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, that kind of makes sense.
Thinking about it, again, when we're talking about space opera, we're looking at films which may have originally been skewed towards a younger audience. Fantasy films are primarily younger viewers, younger readers, are initially the people to get into fantasy, and then you grow up and you carry on with your fantasy sort of passion and it evolves. A complete contrast to Barbarella, which is a lot more, feels more adult, and this is very much more getting the family audiences in, kids especially, who want to see this kind of stuff on screen.
And I think it works really well. I think that if I had seen this when I was a kid, this would stick in my head and it would be like one of my favorite films. Obviously it's not going to like go into my favorite films now as an adult, but watching it for the first time, I did feel that kind of a sense of nostalgia for, you know, for memories that I don't have. It made me feel a little bit like I was a kid watching it, basically. It's really fun. And I think they do a good job of capturing that. And it sounds like it was just up against too much else at the box office to land, because I feel like it could have done well. It could have captured a lot of minds, and I'm sure it did. And that's why they become cult films, don't they? Because enough people remember it that they go on and talk about it. And then 20 years later, they're still talking about it and their friends haven't heard of it because they're the only one who remembers it. But then their friends watch it and they're like, this is ridiculous, but I love it.
And you can see yourself as a kid watching this and just being terrified by certain moments. When you see the changelings with their dark eyes, that's terrifying.
and the beast itself at the end reminded me of the devil from Bill and Ted.
Ah.
You know, like a very scary big monster, but very well designed and cool. That was kind of one of my standout moments. What were your kind of favorite bits of spectacle in the film? I loved that final fight scene with the beast.
There was a lot of them. One of the things I want to talk to you about with in terms of spectacle is the Black Fortress itself. So
sure,
it's this big fortress, and it looks like it's the face of the beast. And there were certain shots in the film where I thought maybe the Black Fortress is the beast, but it turns out it's not. But there's certain shots where you see close-ups of the beast's face and it's just looking around and you can't tell if that's like the side of the fortress. I think, again, it's just probably down to the editing more than anything. But did you get a sense of that?
Yeah, kind of. I know what you mean, because Lyssa is trapped in the fortress for the entirety of the film, but she's the one that actually has conversations with the beast. So the beast is only really depicted on screen before that final fight. The beast is only really depicted on screen as a disembodied voice, bit like Sauron. So in a sense, it does feel like the beast is the building. Lyssa is inside structures that look like eyes and talons and, you know, stuff like that. So considering the beast is completely disembodied for most of the film, in essence, it essentially is the Black Fortress, because that's the only representation of the beast that we see on film. So it does feel that way. But then obviously at the end, there is a big monster.
Yeah, which is
so
great.
It becomes more like, unless that's just a manifestation, I guess, of the beast, or if it literally is, that's what he looks like, that's who he is. The film's kind of too much of a mess to really speculate on what that might be. But I think we see the beast, and I think we're supposed to just take that at face value. That is what he looks like. But he can take any form. He can look like Colwyn. He can He's got changelings working for him. He's got that power.
He's got a lot of special talents, hasn't he, the old beast?
Yeah.
But one of the other things which I really liked in terms of the spectacle and the sheer fantasy nature of it were the fire mares, the flaming horses. Cool. It just seemed so random at the time because they're just like, oh, well, if we use one of these fire mares, then we'll get there straight away. And they just appear to be normal horses.
Yeah.
Until they get on top of them and then start riding. And then there's just these crazy trails that they're flying around on. I really enjoyed that as a moment of spectacle when they're sort of flying about on those fiery horses.
Yeah, I love the fire mares. They're great. They're a great little fantasy concept, aren't they?
Yeah. And there's lots of other sort of big battles and stuff, and the Cyclops is always throwing a spear at someone, and it's all working towards that big climax when they are fighting the beast. And that's what you want to see in the film. You want to see Colwyn fight the beast, use the glaive. He doesn't
use... I want to see him throw the bloody glaive.
He's not using the glaive at all. I mean, I know he gets
warned. 40 minutes before he throws the glaive at anyone.
And when he does throw the glaive, I think for the first time, it's just going at a wall for like 10 minutes.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Actually, so he does use it a bit earlier to rescue Lyssa, or maybe that is what I'm thinking of. But
that moment just goes on for ages. It cuts between other action that's going on. Yeah. He's still just waiting, just like this.
Yeah, he's standing there with his arm extended. Yeah, pretty mad. But then he finally does get into a proper fight with the beast. He's also killing a load of the guards with the glaive. I was quite satisfied with that. I was like, wait, this whole bloody movie to see him throw this shuriken boomerang device. And then he does use it quite a lot. And I was like, yeah, this is cool. I would have loved this when I was a kid.
Did you get as frustrated as I did during the moment when it got stuck in the beast and he couldn't get it out?
Yeah.
He's just trying his hardest. I'm like, just leave it. Just go. It's fine.
Yeah.
He's like, no, I need to go and get the glaive. And he doesn't even fucking get it, does he?
Yeah. And then they have a very confusing conversation about the glaive was the power within all along, and it's the power of our love.
It's definitely not.
And then he can shoot fire from his hands because of that.
I mean, it's a great shuriken that you can control with his mind.
Yeah, it's magic shuriken.
Yeah, it's not in him. I mean, it's mad. So he turns his hand into a flamethrower instead, which is fine.
Yeah. And he's got flame power.
Yeah, there's lots of flame stuff going on in this as well. Fire is everywhere. Again, going back to the natural world.
Yeah. It's a lot of fun though, right? I mean, I really enjoyed it. This would have really captured my imagination as a kid. And I'm sorry to have missed it. I'm keen to see more from this sci-fi and fantasy mashup. That was the most interesting part of the film for me, and I would have liked to see more culture clash between sci-fi characters and fantasy characters facing off. I think there's a lot of fun to be had in that.
Yeah, and you can see, like you said, you can see why it's become a cult film. It's got all of those elements that make it stand out for the time period, and it would stick in your head if you watched it as a kid. Watching it now as an adult, there were moments when I kind of got distracted and I wanted more to be going on, even though there's as much going on as can possibly be. But it didn't engage me in the same way as I would have liked from a film of this period. But I can see 100% why it is a cult film and why so many people love it.
And both of these films they're cult movies, and I think they've got some longevity to them. But next time on the show, we're going to be looking at the big space opera cult movies, the longest reigning in the space opera subgenre. We're dealing with the original trilogy itself, the first three Star Wars movies.
We are indeed. And as Matt has often mentioned, it is the big elephant in the room for our podcast. It's the big, big beastie film series that we have yet to cover on our sci-fi based podcast. So I'm very much looking forward to talking about Star Wars, the original trilogy. And just, I think it's going to be a nostalgic experience as well, Matt.
Yeah, lots to talk about. I think it's going to be a long episode.
It's going to be a bumper episode, I'm sure. I think
Buckle up.
Yeah, there'll be lots to cover because we will be covering Star Wars, Empire Strikes Back, and Return of the Jedi all in one very special episode for you, our treasured listeners.
So join us next time for that. Thanks for listening to this episode of Journey Through Sci-Fi.
You can find us at journeythroughscifi.com, where you can find links to our social media and join the conversation.
If you've enjoyed what you've heard and want to support us, why not leave us a review on your podcast app of choice? It really helps new people find the show.
You can also support us on Patreon at patreon.com/journeythroughscifi, where you can receive exclusive bonus episodes every month.
Don't forget to subscribe to the show, and we'll see you again next time for another Journey Through Sci-Fi.